All right, good morning. Good to see each one of you here this morning. Appreciate so much you being here for our Sunday school hour. Looking forward to getting into God's Word this morning and see what the Lord has in store for us today from His Word. You have your Bibles, let's turn together, if you would please, to Psalm 90. Psalm 90. You remember from your own reading of the Old Testament, you remember how that the Lord God, back in Exodus chapter 3, the Lord God called Moses while he was keeping the sheep of his father-in-law in the land of Midian. And you know the land of Midian is always on the east side of the Gulf of Aqaba, which is the right-hand part of the Red Sea. It goes up and it divides, and Egypt is on the left, and the land of Midian is on the right. So it's on the east side of the Gulf of Aqaba. And so while he was there watching his father-in-law's sheep, the Lord God called him to become the leader of the nation of Israel and to bring them out of Egyptian bondage, and to bring them across the Sinai Peninsula back into the land of Midian to a mountain called the Mount of God or Mount Sinai. And so he has this call, and as a result of that call from the Lord God, you remember how that Moses went. He confronted the Egyptian Pharaoh, demanding that he would let God's people go, release the nation of Israel from their bondage. And of course, the Pharaoh hardened his heart. And as a result of that, Moses then introduced those terrible, painful, destructive, deadly plagues that came on the land of Egypt and on the people of Egypt. And finally, as a result of that, we find that Pharaoh relented and he allowed the people to leave. And so Moses then led them out of Egypt, and he leads them across the Sinai Peninsula. As I said, they come to the Gulf of Aqaba, and so now they're faced with a difficulty, because when they come to the Gulf of Aqaba, the Bible says they were closed in. In other words, there were mountains to the north, mountains to the south, very steep. There was a sea in front of them, and the armies of the Egyptians were coming in behind them. They were literally between the devil and the deep blue sea. And so they're standing there, and of course they're all afraid. They don't know what's going to happen. And Moses comes to the Lord, and the Lord says, "Moses, just be still and see what I'm going to do." And you know the story, right? How that Moses takes his rod and God parts the waters of that Red Sea, and they go through on dry land. And of course, the Egyptian armies are destroyed there. And so they go across into the land of Midian. They go back to that mountain where Moses had been called by God. They go back to Mount Sinai. And there, you remember, God gives to them His law. He gives them His law. From there, after dwelling in that area for about a year, from there they then traveled northward. And they came up to a place called Kadesh Barnea. They came to Kadesh Barnea, and you remember it was in Kadesh Barnea that Moses then, he chose 12 spies, one from each of the 12 tribes of Israel. And he sent those 12 spies into this promised land. He sends them in there to spy it out, to see what it's all about. And you know the story. They go up, and for 40 days, they're scouting around, and they're looking at who is there and what is there and all of that. And so they go up there, and then the Bible tells us in the book of Numbers, in Numbers chapter 13, verse number 22, it says concerning these spies that they brought up an evil report of the land, which they had searched unto the children of Israel, saying, "The land through which we have gone to search it is a land that eateth up the inhabitants thereof, and all the people that we saw in it are men of great stature." In other words, the bottom line is that these men come back with their report. They're bringing back some of the fruits of the land. And they said that the land was a good land, Exodus chapter 3, verse 8. They said it was a good land which the Lord God had promised them. But not only did they have the fruits of it, notice they also said it's a hostile land. God said it's a good land. Men said it's a hostile land. And it's going to eat us up. It's going to be the end of us, the ruin of us. And they brought this report about the people who were in that land. They said, these people are huge. Not only are they bigger than we are, but we have a serious doubt that even our God can overcome such great enemies. We kind of doubt that. If we go up in that land, we're going to die. Bottom line, that's what they're thinking. We go up into that land, we're going to die. And so as a result of their evil report, you remember it. As a result of that evil report that was given, the faith of the people of Israel began to waver, and it was eventually conquered by fear. It's conquered by their fear. And as a result, the Lord God, you remember, they said, we're not going to go up. We're not going to go into the land. And so the Lord God said, well, I'll tell you what's going to happen then. For 40 years. You went up and you spied it out for 40 days. So 1 year for every day, for 40 years, you're going to wander in the wilderness. I'm not going to give you that land. In fact, all of this generation will die in the wilderness, except for Moses and Caleb and Joshua. Except for those three, all the rest of this generation, they're going to die. They're never going to see the glory of that promised land because of their lack of faith, because they refused to obey the Lord God. And so it was at this point, as the nation of Israel turned from Kadesh Barnea to once again wander in the shifting sands of the wilderness, it was at that point that Moses penned the words of the psalm that we're going to see this morning. It's at this point that Moses wrote this psalm. And notice the title. You'll find that it is simply a prayer of Moses, the man of God. It's a prayer of Moses, the man of God. Notice two things we find here. First of all, of course, the writer is identified for us. It is Moses. We see his identity. It is Moses. But then I want you to note, not only do we see his identity, notice we also see his designation. He's declared to be a man of God. As you go through the Old Testament, you'll find that there are only seven men in all of the Old Testament. Only seven men are given this title. Only seven men in the Old Testament are referred to as a man of God. And one of them, Deuteronomy chapter 33, verse 1, one of them was Moses. One of them was Moses. He was a man of God. Charles Spurgeon, I think, said it very well. Here's what he said. He said, Moses was peculiarly a man of God and God's man. He well deserved the name which is here given him. He well deserved the name which is given to him here. And so this is the writer. It's Moses. Moses, the man of God. Then also notice the purpose of it. And just very simply, this is a prayer. This is a record of what Moses prayed. This is the prayer that he prayed to the Lord. Men of God, just mark this down. Moses was a man of God. And just understand that men of God are always sure to be men of prayer. True men of God will always surely be men of prayer. And here we're going to see his prayer for Israel during a time of spiritual failure. We're going to see his prayer for Israel during a time of spiritual rebellion against God. We're going to see his prayer for them during this time of serious spiritual tragedy. And so with that in mind, notice three things we find in this prayer of Moses. Number one, I want us to notice we find his perspective. His perspective. And we're going to see his perspective concerning a couple of things. First of all, concerning God's person. His perspective concerning God's person. And as Moses thinks about the Lord God, there's a couple of things that he's going to hold in his mind. First of all, he understands that God is great. That God is great. Notice in verse number one, it says, Lord. Now you'll notice that this is not all capitals. It's capital L, lowercase O-R-D. In other words, this is not Jehovah that he's talking about. Rather, this is Lord as in master. Or king, okay? And so the name speaks of God in his government. It speaks of God in his sovereignty. He is the mighty God who rules and he controls all the factors of space and time. He is the master. He is Lord. He is Lord. And as such, he is the gracious King of Kings and the Lord of Lords who gives shelter. He gives comfort, he gives protection, preserving and cherishing his own people. He's the Lord. He's the Lord. What a great truth for us to hang on to when we are disappointed by the circumstances of life. What a great truth this is that we can hang on to when we are disappointed by the failures of people. What a great truth this is that we can hang on to, knowing that God is our master. He's our king. And he is in absolute control of everything surrounding our life. Wow, what a great perspective to have concerning our God. What a great perspective to have that he is great. Not only is he great, notice he also had the perspective of God, that God is faithful. God is faithful. Notice again, let's look at verse number 1 and read it in its entirety. Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations. Thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations. The idea that is seen here is that it literally carries the idea to be at home with God, to be at rest with God. A clear picture of this is found over in the book of Ezekiel, in Ezekiel chapter 11, verse number 16. Thus saith the Lord God, although I have cast them far off among the heathen, and although I have scattered them among the countries, yet will I be to them as a little sanctuary in the countries where they shall come. Wow, how faithful. God says, I'm going to scatter them. I'm going to scatter them all over the place. But yet, I'm going to be faithful to them. And I'm going to have a place for them. I'm going to have a place for them. I'll be to them like a little sanctuary. Like a little place where they can come for safety and for blessing. And I'm going to be that for them. And in his prayer, Moses remembers how that all through their history as a people, in every circumstance that they faced, in every situation that they faced, the people of Israel had consistently, they had found the Lord God to be a faithful source of comfort, a faithful source of provision, a faithful source of blessing, a God whose loving compassions never ended. He's faithful. He's faithful. Not only did the perspective of Moses see God's person as being great and being faithful, he also saw that God is eternal. That God is eternal. Verse number 2, here's what he said. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever thou hast formed the earth and the world. In other words, before the creation of anything, before the creation of anything, even from everlasting to everlasting. What does that mean? That simply means all the way from eternity past, all the way through to eternity future. All through the ages of eternity, thou art God. He's eternal. He's eternal. I think about that. There's never been a time when God was not. And there'll never be a time when God is not. He is the eternal God from everlasting to everlasting. And because of this perspective of God, because Moses saw these attributes of God, He then begins to turn his focus, this great, awesome God that we serve. He also begins to realize that this God, he's a God of mercy. And so he begins to focus on God's mercies. Moses is going to mention two things. He's going to mention two things that will cause the great heart of God, the loving heart of God, to look toward men. Two things that will cause God to look toward men in tender mercies. Two things. First of all, there is the tyranny of the tomb. God looks on men with mercy because of the tyranny of the tomb. Verse number 3, thou turnest man to destruction and sayest, return, ye children of men. You turn men to destruction, but then you say, return, you children of men. There's two things that we see here. First of all, we see that there is a penalty. There is a penalty because men have sinned against God. They've rebelled against God. God turns them over to destruction. You remember the historical context. Because of their lack of faith, because of their failure to obey, a whole generation of Jews is going to die in the wilderness. They're going to die in the wilderness. They're never going to see the promised land. They're never going to enjoy the blessings of the promised land. They're going to die out in the wilderness, buried in perhaps unmarked graves. And that's the judgment that's going to come. That's the judgment that would come upon them. And the Hebrew word that is used here, turn this to destruction, it actually carries the idea of being ground to powder. To be ground to powder. Because of sin, all men die if you stop and think about it. And you know what we become? We become like powder, right? The dust of the earth. We were made from dust. We go back to dust. And that's exactly the way it is. But not only is there a penalty, there is also a resurrection. In His loving kindness, the Lord God will say to that pile of dust, return to the land of the living. In judgment, I'm going to grind you to dust, but return now. Return to the land of the living. In other words, Moses is speaking of that day when God will break the tyranny of the tomb. But that's not all. That's not all. He's also going to break the tyranny of the clock. The tyranny of the clock. Someone has well said, and just think about this, it's a pretty profound thought when you kind of stop and consider it. But just think about this. Time is the stuff that life is made of. Time. Time is the stuff that life is made of. But in the day of the resurrection, time will mean nothing. Time will mean nothing in that resurrection day because notice what he says in verse number 4. He says, for 1,000 years in thy sight are but as yesterday when it is past, and as a watch in the night. As a watch in the night. If you've ever done military service, you know what that means. A watch in the night, that's 4 hours. That's 4 hours. That's a watch in the night. And that's exactly the shortness of time, that while now we live under the tyranny of time, when we go to be with the Lord, we will be delivered from that. In fact, I'm pretty sure, and I can't prove this from the Bible, but I'm pretty sure that when we get to heaven, you won't have a wristwatch. You won't need it. You won't need it. Because we'll be freed from the tyranny of time. In fact, the Bible puts it this way in 1 Thessalonians 4:17, so shall we ever be. There's no end to it. Time is no longer a factor. So shall we ever be with the Lord. What a great and merciful God we serve. What a great and merciful God we serve. But while His awesomeness and mercies are wonderful, while they are wonderful to consider, there's another side of God that we must never forget. There's another side of God, and that is we must never forget the perspective concerning God's severity. Concerning God's severity. Again, remember the historical context. That whole generation, That whole generation of Jews are going to die in the wilderness. They're going to be buried in the wilderness. They're never going to see the land of promise. And you know why? You know what their crime was? Why this judgment has come upon them? It's simply because they refused to believe the promise of God. They refused to obey what God commanded them to do because they doubted that God would keep His word. Did you know that people today, many people in our world today, are going to die and they're going to spend eternity in hell? You know why? Simply, not because they didn't, I mean, there are many who will do that because they've never heard, but there are many more who will die and go to hell simply because they refused to believe. They refused to obey. And as a result of that, God's severity is going to come because of His absolute holiness. Don't ever forget this. Because of His absolute holiness, God must deal with sin. He cannot allow sin to just go. He cannot allow it to be just overlooked. And God has to deal with sin. And He even has to deal with the sin of His own people. Don't think just because we're Christians, oh yeah, we're free. No, we're not free to do as we please. We're not free to do whatever we want to do. God deals with sin, even the sins of His own people. And so Moses, he's talking about God's people. He's talking about God's nation. He's talking about the Israelites. Here's what he says, verse 5 and verse number 6. Thou carriest them away as with a flood. That's what God does to His people. That's what He does to His people. He carries them away as with a flood. They are as asleep. In the morning, they are like grass which groweth up. In the morning, it flourisheth and groweth up. And in the evening, it is cut down and it withers. That's how God deals with His own people when they rebel. That's how God deals with His own people when they sin against Him, when they refuse to obey Him. Listen, if that's what God does to His own people, what can you imagine what it's like for those who do not know Him, who have no relationship with Him? And so after revealing these things, these perspectives that Moses had concerning the Lord God, these three perspectives have now brought him to what we might call His understanding. Here's what he understands. First of all, he understands that men are sinful. Men are sinful. Verse 7 and verse number 8. For we are consumed by thine anger, and by thy wrath are we troubled. Thou hast set our iniquities before thee, our secret sins in the light of thy countenance. Did you catch that? How many times do we find ourselves in a situation where we're tempted to do something and we know we shouldn't do it? We know it's not right. And so we're tempted to do that, and so we started kind of looking over our shoulder to see if there's any church members around. See if anybody's watching who knows us. And we kind of start looking around, and then, you know, if we don't see anybody, then many times we follow through with our desire to do that which is not right. And yet I want you to notice our secret sins. Those sins that nobody knows about. And it's not just sins of action. It's the sinful attitudes that we harbor in the depths of our heart that nobody knows about. No, nobody can see them. It's those secret sins. And they're all brought into the presence of God's light. And what is secret? It's no longer secret. It's all revealed. It's all revealed. How foolish it is to think. How foolish it is to think that we can sin against God and get away with it. How foolish it is to think that we can do that. You see, even though we may successfully hide our sin, our sinful actions, our sinful attitudes, you know what I'm talking about? Sinful attitudes. That's when we put on a happy face and we come to church and, oh, hey, brother so-and-so, hey, sister so-and-so. And inside we're thinking, I'd love to kill you. I know nobody in our church ever does that, but there's people who do that. You may not believe that, but it's true. Yeah, those secret attitudes, those secret actions, nothing is going to be hidden. Even those secret sins, God is going to set them out before His light, and He will not forget. He will not forget. That's another problem that brings to our attention. Not only is there the problem that men are sinful, there's also the problem that our time is short. Time is limited. Again, verse 9 and verse number 10, for all our days are passed away in thy wrath. We spend our years as a tale that is told. The days of our years are 70. That's 70. 70 years. And if by reason of strength they be 80 years, that's 80, yet is their strength labor and sorrow, for it is soon cut off, and we fly away. We fly away. In other words, we depart from this life. We have our 70 years, and if by reason of strength we make it to 80. This was my father-in-law's favorite verse before he passed away. He said, I'm 80 plus now, and I can testify to the fact that once you turn 80, your strength is gone and it's just full of trouble. All kinds of physical problems come in. All kinds of physical problems come in. And these days of our life, the years of our life, even though that sounds like a lot, I mentioned 70. And some of you are thinking, wow, boy, that is really old. Trust me, it's not as old as it used to be for me. I'm 70 plus. I'm 70 plus now, looking at 80, okay? Hope to live that long. But these years, I can tell you right now, I'm 73, but I still think I'm 20. Until I start exercising, and then my body reminds me, you ain't 20, buddy. Yeah. Our lives are short. Seems like just yesterday I was a young man. Now I'm not. And you can identify with that, right? I mean, we all feel the same way. No matter how old you are, you look back and you say, wow, where has the time gone? It has flown by. Our lives are sinful. Our lives are short. We need to understand that. And when we begin to realize that we are sinful and our time on this earth is short, it's like a tale that is told, Moses said. We begin to understand that, then we begin to realize just this very important truth. And that is that life is serious. Life is serious. The seriousness of life is seen in the fact that we're all going to one day stand before God. And you know what we're going to answer for? We're going to answer for how we have lived our life. We're going to give an account to God for how we have spent our time, how we have spent our money, how we have used the blessings that He's given to us. We're going to give an account to God for the way we've used the days of our life. Remember, the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27, it's appointed unto man once to die. And then after that, there is a judgment. And many times Christians think, oh yeah, that's for the unsaved. Well, you're right. The unsaved are going to stand before God. There is a judgment for the unsaved. But don't forget this. There's also a judgment for the believer. The judgment for the unsaved is the great white throne judgment, where their eternal destiny will be carried out. But for the believer, it's the judgment seat of Christ. Has nothing to do with our salvation, has to do with our service for God during our lifetime. That's all going to be tried by fire. And those things that we have done for God that go through the fire without being burned up, those things are going to be rewarded. It's appointed unto man once to die. There is going to be a judgment. And it's God's judgment that Moses has in mind. It's this judgment of God that Moses has in mind when he says in verse number 11, "Who knoweth the power of your anger?" Who knows the power of your anger? The obvious answer is nobody. Nobody knows that. Nobody knows that. Because we've all have a sinful nature. Sin is natural for us, and therefore it is not possible for us to understand the depth of anger that God has for those who sin against Him. It's impossible. Sin is our nature. And so it's impossible for us to know just how offensive we are in the eyes of a holy God. No way we can comprehend that. No way we can comprehend that. But if you try to imagine the fear of falling into the hands of an angry God, no matter how frightening your imagination may be, I want you to notice that His wrath will be worse than your worst fears. If you try to imagine just how frightening it's going to be to stand before an angry God, the reality is going to be worse than your worst fears. It'll be worse than your worst fear. Notice in verse 11, "Even according to thy fear, so is thy wrath." So is thy wrath. Because of that, Moses prayed something that we all ought to be praying. Moses is going to make a prayer request that all of us ought to pray. Here's what he says in verse number 12. He says, so. And because we're all going to stand before God, because there is coming a day of judgment for all men, so teach us. Teach us to number our days. Teach us to number our days that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom. God, it's a serious thing, this thing we call life. It's not something we just go through and okay, sarah, sarah, whatever will be. No. It's a serious thing, this thing we call life. Because we're going to answer to God for how we live this life. And so our prayer ought to be, God, please help us to number our days. We may apply our hearts to wisdom, living in a way that is wise, not living according to the foolishness of this world, but living a life that is truly wise in the eyes of God. And it was that desire then, it was that desire to apply his heart to wisdom. It's that desire that led Moses then to present number three, his request. Understanding these things that we've mentioned, now he's going to present his request. First of all, there is a request for God's forgiveness. For God's forgiveness. By the way, we all need that, don't we? No matter who we are, no matter what level we may have reached in our spiritual maturity and in our walk with God, all of us have failed, and we fail daily. And because of that, all of us need to pray and ask for God's forgiveness. We need God's forgiveness. Verse number 13, "Return, O Lord," how long? "And let it repent thee concerning thy servants." In other words, Moses was praying that God might be glorified. Get this, that God would be glorified by the salvation of his people rather than by the destruction of his people. That God would be glorified by their salvation, not their destruction. And so he prays for God's forgiveness. Not only that, he prays for God's mercies. He prays for God's mercies. Verse 14 and verse 15. Oh, satisfy us early with thy mercy, that we may rejoice and be glad all our days. Make us glad according to the days wherein thou hast afflicted us, and the years wherein we have seen evil. Remember, this people that Moses is praying about, this was God's chosen people. This is the nation of Israel. They have been afflicted for 400 years. 400 years they have been in Egyptian bondage. For 400 years they have been ruled by those cruel taskmasters. For 400 years, they've had a life that was filled with trouble and difficulties and miseries. And Moses desired that the Lord God would forgive their sin and give them an equal part. In other words, they've had 400 years of misery, 400 years of trouble. His desire is that God would give them an equal part, 400 years of blessing and happiness. Basically, that's what he's praying about. And so he beseeches God for his forgiveness, for his mercies, and then also this. He beseeches God for his presence. For his presence. His presence seen in the way he works. Seen in the way he moves. Here's how Moses said it. Let thy work appear unto thy servants. In other words, the desire of Moses is that God's presence with them would be so close that they would be able to see his working in their midst. See him at work in their midst. Not only seen in his working, but God's presence, Moses desired that it might be seen in his glory. Notice again verse 16. And thy glory unto their children. Even though Israel was in the wilderness, Moses desired for the Shekinah glory of the Lord God, for the Shekinah glory of the Lord God to continually fill the tabernacle. Stop and think about it. They disobeyed at Kadesh Barnea. They walked away from what God wanted them to do. They walked away from the place where God wanted them to be. And yet as they carried their tabernacle away from the place where God said, here's what I want you to do, yet that Shekinah glory went with them. God's presence seen in his glory. And so Moses, as he prays now, his request is God's forgiveness, God's mercies, God's presence. Number four, God's blessings. God's blessings. Verse number one. Let the beauty of the Lord our God be upon us. That's not verse number one. It's the last verse. But let the beauty of the Lord our God be upon us. In other words, may we have his abiding presence with us. Let his beauty be with us. And establish thou the work of our hands. In other words, may the works we do in this life be set by him. May they be directed by him. May they be empowered by him. And so let us see your presence. Let the beauty of God be upon us. Let the work of our hands be established by you. Yea, the work of our hands, establish thou it. Establish thou it. This is a great prayer. It's a great prayer. And I pray that as we consider these things, that we might be able to understand the truths that are presented here. And that we might be able to honestly say with the missionary C.T. Studd, missionary to Africa, he wrote a poem. And the first verse of the poem that he wrote goes like this. Two little lines I heard one day, traveling along life's busy way, bringing conviction to my heart and from my mind would not depart. And here's the two little lines. Only one life, 'twill soon be past. And only what's done for Christ is going to last. That's it. That's it. May God help us to never lose sight of this simple truth. As we consider the prayer of Moses, may we understand the principles that he has shown to us, and may we ever strive to live accordingly, living for God, putting Him first, obeying what He would have for us to do, that we might enjoy the blessings that He desires to give to us, and the blessings He desires to bring through us to others. Only one life. That's all we got. You don't get it right the first time. You don't get a redo. You don't get a takeover. No, there's only one life. It's going to be soon past. And only what we do for Christ is going to count for time and for eternity. So may God help us to choose wisely what we do.